దీని ఇన్వెస్ట్మెంట్ అండ్ ఇతో దీని రీసెర్చ్ దే యూస్ టు డెవలప్ దట్ సో దిస్ ప్రూవ్స్ దట్ నేచురల్లీ దేర్ ఇస్ అ సబ్జెక్టివిటీ అండ్ కనెక్టివిటీ ఎవ్రీథింగ్ యాస్ అదర్ బీయింగ్స్ ఎట్ ఆఫ్ హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్ దే హావ్ నో అదర్ ఆప్షన్ ఎక్సెప్ట్ టు అబైడ్ బై ది నేచురల్ రూల్ అండ్ ఆబ్లిగేషన్స్ దే ఆర్ హావింగ్ ఆల్ ది ప్రొవిజన్స్ ఆఫ్ నేచురల్ బౌండీ యాస్ వి ఆర్ నాట్ అబైడింగ్ బై ద రూల్స్ ఆఫ్ నేచర్ విచ్ ఇస్ ద బేసిక్ ఫ్రేమ్ వర్క్ ఇన్ విచ్ వి హావ్ టు మేక్ అవర్ సస్టెనెన్స్ వి ఆర్ వెరీ మచ్ టెస్టెడ్ బై బగ్స్ థగ్స్ అండ్ డ్రగ్స్ So there is only option left for us, so we have to suffer by this. So this is the natural rule by which there are two things. One is the natural bounty, second is elasticity. Nature that provides you everything and it is also flexible to a reasonable amount. So if the nature is a real bounty, if it is violated, if the norms are violated, you will suffer. If the elasticity is mistaken and for overconsumption, if you mishandle it by exploitation, you will suffer. This is the rule. And who knows that? All the other living beings in the world, they know that. All the other living beings, by their inner sense, they know that. For all the other living beings, there is a provision to know. Whereas for human beings, there needs a vision to know. He needs a special provision. Somebody has to advise him. Somebody has to educate him. So he is in such a condition, pitiable condition, that in spite of having everything inside, he needs an extra guidance or instigation to realize all of these things, which is known to the basic physical instinct of all living beings. This ideology proves that there is a common network which carries everything. The common network has a hub, axis, or nucleus, whatever you call, and that is all-knowing, that is an intelligent design. That omniscience not only accounts you like an auditor, but governs you. That watches you, whatever you do today, everything is watched. Whatever you are doing to yourself, you are doing to other people, you are doing to nature, everything is recorded. Everything is recorded by the five elements, everything is recorded by your conscience or the immanence of God. So everything is watched. And God, by through nature or by your own fellow beings or even by yourself, He gives the contributive and retributive justice. By three destinies. One is a personal destiny of a person, collective destiny due to misbehavior of a community, or global destiny like global warming. Either it is a personal, collective, or global, or universal. He gives everything like that. Then somebody may ask, if there is such a force which is governing everything, meticulously watching everything, and giving the retributive and contributive justices, why it is not giving like that? So there is a rule for its maturity and fructification. One is immediate maturity. Second is cumulative maturity. Cumulative maturity is of three types, vamshantara, kalantara, dehantara. It is trans-physical, trans-generational, and it is trans-temporal. It may take few decades, that is kalantara. It may affect your younger generations or forthcoming generations, that is vamshantara. Or it may just subtly, it may be inside you, imbibing all of your inner resources, spoiling you inside and taking a proper opportunity to give you a proper blow at your succeeding generations, birth generations in the form of transmigration. So either in your consecutive births or with your following generations or in your later decades, certainly you have to harvest what you have sown today. That is the rule of dharma. There are innumerable dharmas. One is swadharma, that is personal duty. Second is vishishta dharma, special duty. The third thing is apadharma, that is emergency course. Fourth thing is adhikara dharma, that which is exclusive for few people. And fifth is samanya dharma, that which is common for all living beings. Kalantara dharma, that is time bounded. And we are having sandarbhika dharma, which is environmental or circumstantial. So dharma not only put mere rules. Yes, eat two bananas daily, a doctor can give you prescription. But bananas will be given only by your mother, doctor will not give. But dharma is not like that. Dharma gives you rules, the methods to practice dharma. It also emphasizes the need for dharma so that you will get personal interest. Number four, it also admonishes the ill effects of not practicing dharma and also give warning about the various diversifiers in the society which may take you away from the pathway of dharma. It gives also remedial measures. Why remedial measures are given? For two reasons. It is for giving the choice of excuse and enhancement. What is the definition for remedy? Remedy is a God-given choice for excuse and enhancement. If you are not having any remedial mechanism or measure, then you cannot have an excuse from God. You must have a choice for that. And also this will pave the way for your enhancement. So this is what we call dharma. Next we are coming to artha. Artha is any resource. Resource is defined as any element which is vitally or supportively essential for conducting, commencing or completing an action. So it may be anything. Shastra says that there are three inner resources. The first is Udvega, which comes from Icha, and the third thing is Dhi. Icha is known as desire, Udvega is known as dynamism, Dhi is known as proper direction. We must have these three things. These are the perfect inner resources. And which is the perfect outer resource? The first resource is Mother Earth, Goddess Earth. Whenever we live in the world, we are in the womb of Mother Earth. Whenever we walk outside our homes, we are in the lap of our Mother Earth. So Mother is really the mother of all resources, and we have to pray Earth, and we have prayed Earth to be Mother. And I want to say a very interesting subject in this. Mother feeds by two methods. One is a hand feed, second is a breast feed. Breastfeed is given for the immature child, newborn child, and this hand feed is given for the grown or mature people. For the Westerners, Artha and Kama is the breastfeed, and Dharma and Moksha is a hand feed which they realize later. But those who are born in India, our mother feed is Dharma and Moksha. Then only we will get knowledge about Artha and Kama, which is the hand feed after that. So our basis, whenever we talk about some resources, the resources are common for all mankind. If the father earns some wealth, that is for all family members. So if India has some knowledge, unless somebody is disobedient or totally having some aversive opinion about India, certainly that India is for global welfare and global prosperity. It is not secularly for India. Why it is applied only for Indians? Because they only had the mind setup to accept and practice. That is the problem. Anybody having the mind setup and practice, they can do that. India is a land of people who had a conducive atmosphere and an unbreakable lineage by which this mind setup, personal interest and involvement has been brought over centuries. That is the only reason, not any discrimination like that. So, for us, the breast milk is Dharma and Moksha. We have been fed by the hand of Mother Earth about Artha and Kama. Later, that is the greatness of our India. Whenever we talk about the resources, there are inexhaustible resources and exhaustible resources. There are surface resources of Earth, like plants and water. Subtle resources of our environment, which are known as, that is nano power. We are having electricity, we are having spintronics technology which is going to come. We are using the subtle sources of the environment, that is the subtle power or subtle resources. The third thing is storage resources like coal, petroleum and other things. So we have space or surface, we have storage and we have subtle resources. These are all called as Artha. If you say Artha, Artha encompasses everything. Apart from this, there are two divisions of resources, cyclic resources and non-cyclic. Even in cyclic resources which are renewable or replenishable, those resources are of instacyclic and megacyclic. If you totally exhaust coal or some other storage in the earth, then the cyclic repetition will be after several millenniums or after the deluge. When the recreation is there, we may get it back. But whereas water and other things, immediately they are evaporated and we get the rain. So those things are instacyclic. These are the resources. But we must understand, just as we need everything, Earth also for its activities, Earth is also cooking its food through the magma. Earth also requires some sustenance through the resources. We must not over-exploit by which the Earth will be totally collapsed and which is nothing but the collapse of the whole mankind. For example, if somebody is very thirsty, if he is driving a car, he should not drink the water inside the radiator. Because that is required for the car to proceed. So, Earth also requires a lot of resources. We must take it in such a manner. So, somebody may ask, we are growing by population. We are growing by population, demands are growing, we are expanding, how we can restrict? It is told in Shastra, your usage, that is Upayoga, your usage, this is a very important phenomenon, your usage cyclically brings back only 25% of the resources, because that will be subjected to depletion. But Dharma, the truth and morality that you follow, that increases the elasticity and superplasticity of the earth's resources. Just as milk oozes out when a child is given birth from a mother, whenever a person is born in the earth, it is a phenomenon of Veda. Whenever a person is born in the surface of the earth, immediately the resources for his food, the survival establishment is equally, equipotentially, equitemporally secreted. When each and everybody is born, his resources are instantaneously and equitemporally they are secreted. And more the population will be, more the demand will be. Earth is having elasticity to widen the space and super plasticity to augment its resources. It is understandable only by Vedas, not by any size. We are thinking about